president of the Texas Federalist Society. We have a really exciting debate planned for y'all today, so I hope you guys enjoy. Also, it's not too late to pay your dues and become a member. It's only $5, and you can see merit at the end. We've had a really, really, really good showing so far as far as members go. We want to keep that up. It's very important for our organization as far as funding, and just beating Harvard always feels good, too. So if you don't mind checking out with merit at the end, that'd be great. And if you haven't got a pocket constitution, we still have a ton left. So make sure you see one of the other authors. Yes, thank you. Now I'm going to hand it over to Ashley, my VP of speakers, to get us started. Thank you.
Okay, so for our Constitution Day debate, Constitution Day is tomorrow, we have two wonderful speakers. Over here we have Professor Vladeck. Professor Vladeck is the newest constitutional law professor at the University of Texas School of Law. His teaching and research focus on federal jurisdiction, constitutional law, and national security law. A 2004 graduate of Yale Law School, Vladeck clerked for the Honorable Marsha S. Berzon on the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit, and the Honorable Rosemary Barkett on the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Eleventh Circuit. While a law student, he was executive editor of the Yale Law Journal and the student director of the Balancing Civil Liberties and National Security Post 9/11 Litigation Project. Professor Vladeck is now a nationally recognized expert on the role of federal courts in the war on terrorism, and his prolific and widely cited scholarship has appeared in an array of legal publications, including the Harvard Law Review and the Yale Law Journal, and his popular writing has been published in forums ranging from the New York Times to BuzzFeed. Professor Sachs is a professor from Duke University. He is a scholar of civil procedure, constitutional law, and Anglo-American legal history and conflict of law. His research spans a variety of substantive topics, focusing on the history of procedure and private law and its implications for current disputes. His research interests include federal jurisdiction, constitutional interpretation, sovereign immunity, and the legal status of corporations. He received his JD in 2007 from Yale Law School, where he was also executive editor of the Yale Law Journal, and served both as executive editor and articles editor of the Yale Law and Policy Review. Professor Sachs clerked for Chief Justice John Roberts during the 2009-2010 Supreme Court term, and clerked for Judge Stephen F. Williams on the U.S. Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit. So if you could please, if you guys could please just join me in welcoming our speakers.
Thank you very much for that introduction, and thank you to all of you for coming and to the FedSoc chapter for inviting me. I really appreciate it. I hope that it is worth your while, including burrito. If you don't mind, two of us, I think, will sit and talk here. Today we are discussing living constitution and originalism. In some way, the setting stacks the deck a little bit because we are celebrating Constitution Day, which normally is held on the 17th of September to remember the signing of the Constitution in Philadelphia in 1787, as opposed to Living Constitution Day, which is celebrated every April 25th, which is the birthday of Justice Brennan. But in some ways, the real Constitution Day was not the signing in Philadelphia. The real Constitution Day is June 21st every year, commemorating in 1788 in New Hampshire, became the ninth state to ratify, and the Constitution actually became law. Originalism, as I understand it, is the view that our Constitution, the one that we still celebrate every year, is the original Constitution, the one that was signed in 1787, became law in 1788, and the law that it makes and the law that it still makes today is the original law, the law that it created when it was adopted. The view that I take for originalism is that what's law today was law at the founding or has been legally added since then. Such as amendments and statutes and so on. Every piece of law that's part of our system has to have some sort of chain of titles, some sort of pedigree, taking it back to the founding and explaining how it got to be here, what made it law, what gave it legal authority. You could sum up my version of originalism by saying that whatever is law either was law or is made so by law. Now, not everyone talks about originalism this way. Originalism is a many-feathered thing. You're going to hear many different understandings and approaches, and different justices sometimes use it the wrong way or different ways at various points in their career. Some people look a lot to original intent. What did the framers think? What were they trying to say at Philadelphia? Or maybe they look to the ratifiers who actually gave it legal authority. What were they trying to do, trying to accomplish? other people look at the question of what did it mean, even if we know what the ratifiers or framers were trying to say, what would an ordinary or a sophisticated legal reader of the Constitution have understood back then? I think that both of those questions are important, but they're important because they tell us about something else, which is what we actually care about, namely, what law did the Constitution make? When we pass a statute, the thing we really care about is not what the words say or what they mean, so much as what law the statute adds, what it does to our legal system, how it changes. Now, as everyone knows, con law has changed a lot over time. What you guys are learning in your first year class is...
Or not learning.
Or not learning. Maybe. You got this guy. Not necessarily what people would have learned or not learned many years ago. And how do you account for that kind of change? I think any take on the law generally, and constitutional law in particular, has to have some view on how things change and what stays the same, what's fixed. You can't have a world in which absolutely everything is fixed, because then you can't apply the same rule to new facts. The very idea of having legal rules means that they can take account of new facts and give you a new answer. So if we just said, you know, oh my gosh, some new person has committed murder, what do? We don't have any rules for this. Like, no, we've got a rule in the books that says every time it happens, murder is illegal. And that is something that looks to a new fact and says, here's the correct legal answer, but here's the correct legal answer according to a pre-existing rule that we already had on the books. I think that the choice of rule is a choice about what facts make the difference. At the same time, you can't have a world where absolutely everything is in flux, absolutely everything is up for grabs, because then you don't have any idea what the legal rules are. You know, did that passing cloud or gentle breeze just repeal the tax code? I don't know. How could you tell? Every day is a new day. Any legal system has some principles about what's fixed and how exactly new events make a change or don't make a change in the law. So what does that mean for originalism? As I understand it, originalism is a view that looks to old law and allows at least three different kinds of changes. The first are changes that occur simply by applying the same old rule to new facts. You know, we have a murder statute in the book, you know, new event occurs, we have our answer. And this happens in the Constitution too. So the Constitution is written in 1787. The framers thought that North Carolina was going to have fewer seats in Congress than Maryland. That's how they set up the House. Then they did the first census, and they were like, oh my gosh, I guess Maryland gets more seats. Then North Carolina gets more seats than Maryland.
Thank you, slaves.
In addition to the both states were slave states at the time. And the reason for that was that they had a rule in the Constitution that said you get seats based on your numbers and based on the three test clause. We should remember in passing that this is not a claim that sort of old rules are good rules. This is an excellent example thereof. And also, we should remember in passing that just because something was part of the Constitution back then didn't mean necessarily that we respect it because sort of the framers were so great. You know, the claim for why, for instance, we recognize the Communications Act 1996 is not because we really love Newt Gingrich and all of his fellows who were in Congress then. It's not sort of filial piety back to the 96. It's that Congress passed it, and it hasn't been repealed yet. In the same way, the rules that were set down in the Constitution, that every state gets seats based on its numbers in the House, and every state gets the same number of seats in the Senate, were passed then and haven't been changed yet. And so they stay the law today. In the same way, that works for both things that stay the same and things that change. The Commerce Clause applies to commerce in microchips, even though there weren't any microchips at the founding, because it states a rule that takes account of facts in a certain way. That's what it is to have a rule. A second way that the law can change under originalism is that the original law might have rules of change. So there's an Article 5 that says you do certain things, you can amend the Constitution, you can make it say something else. You can outlaw slavery, you can expand the vote, you can do a whole bunch of things through that procedure. You have statutes that both states and the federal government can pass that can do various things, they can create all sorts of agencies, and those types of changes might allow new types of changes, and so on and so forth. But when you look at changes that occur that way, they occur through legal processes. A law is passed according to legal forms, it creates legal authority for some agency to issue regulations, all of these things happen by and through law. A third way that the law can change, even consistent with originalism, is through what I've called domesticated doctrines. Things that take something weird that happened that probably violated the law back then and bless it, say, like, it's okay. We're not going to have any problems. So an example for this for you guys who are in property class might be adverse possession. How many of you covers that. I know there are a bunch of 1Ls. Okay, some. So the idea of adverse possession is basically, if you get on someone's land and you sit there for long enough, it becomes yours. And that sounds pretty crazy, but the basic idea behind it is if someone wants to say, hey, this law school was actually my land in 1793, and so it now has to be torn down, people say, no, you know, we're going to chase back the chain of title, you know, who got it from who got it from who, but eventually we say it's part of our legal rules in any given state, like, no, we're only looking 40 years back, and before then we just don't open the books. In some ways, stare decisis works in that way. If the courts have come to the wrong interpretation of something, it still might be binding on some lower court to say, we must, as a lower court, assume that the Supreme Court is wise and knows what it's doing. And so, of course, people who live in the District of Columbia are citizens of a state for purposes of Article 3, because the Supreme Court hath said so. Now, that doesn't mean that the Supreme Court gets to make up all the rules. If they just declared, you know, one day, like, we are now the committee of 9 emperors, or 8, I guess. It wouldn't work. No one would say, like, yes, that's what something the Supreme Court gets to do in our system. But we have a legal rule called stare decisis that for certain purposes and for to a certain extent, we assume that what the court said got it right. But to an originalist, those kinds of rules like adverse possession or stare decisis aren't just a general, hey, that's old, so we don't need to worry about it argument. It's more that there's something else that really is part of our law, that's part of the law of the founding, that we can trace all the way back, that has legal authority to close off certain kinds of questions and supply certain kinds of answers. And here I think we get to the nub of the disagreement between originalism and the living constitution. So if you are a living constitutionalist, at least the way that I understand the distinction, that may not be the way Professor Vladeck understands the distinction, it would be good for us to work that out. What it means is that you accept certain kinds of legal changes that weren't legal when they occurred. You accept certain divergences from the law of the founding and the way things have happened since. You say, look, when that at the time that happened, we can't justify it, but nonetheless, it is law today. That sounds a little bit stark, but it also has certain kinds of attractions. If you look at what people generally do in the legal system, a lot of things are hard to justify that way. Take, for example, the Fourth Amendment exclusionary rule, the rule that if the police sees something in violation of the Fourth Amendment, it can't be introduced to trial, even if it's relevant probative evidence, even if it's the bloody knife that shows that somebody was guilty. You didn't have that rule at the founding. You didn't see it pretty much anywhere till the 1900s, maybe not until a Supreme Court decision that was kind of confused in Weeks versus United States in 1914. Today, it's pretty common. Courts all over the place will enforce that rule. And the question that originalists would ask about the rule is, okay, how did it get here? What made it the law? Was that what the Fourth Amendment originally required? If not, did something happen in the 19th century to make it the law? You know, was the some new amendment passed or something else happened? If not, did the Supreme Court, you know, have some power to just make it the law in Weeks when it decided that? If not, because that sounds a little weird too, was there something that happened since then, like just practice for a long time that made it the law? Well, what's the warrant for that? Why would that have any effect? So what originalism is doing is basically saying, let's trace all this back. Let's look for the sort of historical source of authority traced back to whatever was law at the founding and whatever has been legally done thereunder since. And so for a living constitutionalist, you might get into a situation where you say, hey, look, I'm willing to concede historically that the Fourth Amendment wasn't the rule of the founding. I'm willing to concede historically that nothing in the 19th century changed that, that, you know, Weeks was wrong the day it was decided, that there isn't any doctrine of stare decisis which traced all the way back to the founding would justify adhering to it today, but nonetheless we should do it because it's the law we've sort of gotten used to. Now that may not be Professor Vladeck's position, might not be the position of many others, but I think that that in some way is the core of the living constitutionalist position, that there's just a lot of water under the bridge and we do things differently now. That's a possible argument. There are a lot of countries around the world that aren't originalist. But I think that what makes America an originalist legal system is the fact that at least at the level of theory, at the level of rhetoric, we still think that our Constitution is the one that was signed in 1787 and ratified in 1788. We're not like France. We don't have a fifth republic. We're living in the first republic, the republic that we started with. We're not a country like the United Kingdom that has an unwritten constitution that changes with practice and experience over time. We're a country where we look to sources of legal authority and require actual legal warrant for the changes that have occurred since. I think that's the core of the difference between originalism legal and constitutionalism. It may convince you that originalism is silly. If I've done that, I'll still think that it's a victory, at least to understand things well, but I hope that some of you at least find some of the attraction of originalism somewhat more plausible when we're done here today. Thank you. All right, I agree with none of that. That's actually not true. So let me start with one slight point, which is I think we're in the Third Republic. So I think the Articles of Confederation were a different system than the one we have. And I would actually say that we're in a very different constitutional system post-1868 than we were pre-1868. But, you know, that's nomenclature. I want to sort of offer four general reflections that I think in some ways dovetail with what Steve said, and in some ways actually I think are radically at odds with what he said. So point number one, I don't think originalism and living constitutionalism are necessarily in tension with each other. Right, so this debate was framed as originalism versus living constitutionalism. I'm not sure that's always true. And here's why, right? The true original meaning of some provisions may very well be inherently dynamic. So for example, take the Eighth Amendment, which prohibits cruel and unusual punishment and prohibits excessive fines. Terms the Supreme Court has long held must be measured against evolving standards of decency. Now, Steve might say that's an example of a new fact, right, against a baseline rule. I say it's malleable language that necessarily presupposes a shifting baseline, right, and that there are lots of examples of the Constitution of language like that. I don't even think the most ardent defenders of originalism would argue that a fine today is excessive if the same fine would have been excessive in 1791. Otherwise, speeding tickets go, right? We're all good. Not because the language, not because originalism is irrelevant, but because the original understanding was that the term was measured against an evolving baseline, right? So right off the bat, there are some provisions of the Constitution that are meant to be, in my view at least, dynamic, not static. And to me, that's the real debate. Which provisions are dynamic and which are static? So contrast the Eighth Amendment with other provisions like the Article I and Article II age qualifications. You have to be 25 to be in the House, 30 to be in the Senate, 35 to be president, or the number of seats per state in the Senate, where I think there's just no argument that our understanding has or should have evolved. Even Justice Brennan on his worst day, I think, would not have argued that you can't be president unless you are 35 adjusted for contemporary understandings of life expectancy. Right? So, you know, there's some... It's too easy to set these up as like poles with where there's no room in between. And that's because not all language is created equal, right? Instead, to me, the real debate is not between originalism and living constitutionalism. It's over which language in the Constitution is more susceptible to static interpretation and which language is better suited to dynamic interpretation. And this leads to my second point. Sometimes, even where the Constitution's language seems to be clear and unambiguous, perhaps justifying more of a static interpretive approach, it can produce absurd and surely unintended results. My common law students have heard this one already, but you know, for those of you who haven't, who presides if the vice president is ever impeached? The vice president, right? If you read Article 1, Section 3, Clause 4, it says the vice president presides over the Senate. Article 1, Section 3, Clause 5 makes an exception for the impeachment trial of the president, because of course the vice president would have an interest in that case. The Chief Justice presides then, but no other time, right? So if we wanted to impeach Aaron Burr would have had a good time saying, nice try, you're out of order. You're all out of order. Second, the Air Force, right? There is no Air Force in the Constitution. You guys say, well, obviously there's no Air Force in the Constitution. There weren't planes in 1788 or 91. And I say, exactly. So what is the language in the Constitution that says it's perfectly constitutional for Congress to create an Air Force? I have an answer, right? It's the power to raise armies, because I interpret the word army dynamically, right? Because to me, that word has to evolve as we understand the different means, right? Army is not a literal term for the U.S. Army. Army is a more subjective term for armed forces. Third, more fundamentally, the relationship between the militia and the regular military. If we want to be true, dyed-in-the-wool, original intent originalists, right? The regular military at the founding was deeply distrusted, was not supposed to do anything domestically except maybe repel invasions, and we were going to be saved by the militia,
You guys know who the militia were? Us, right? We the people, because we were gonna go out and fight the British. That didn't work very well, right? By 1799, Congress had already abandoned the fiction that it would be the militia who would save us from the Brits. And this is the same Congress that had people like James Madison in it, people who wrote the Constitution, they gave up. Why? Because the original meaning just was producing an absurd result where we couldn't defend ourselves properly. So what do we do when there seems to be pretty clear tensions between the text and objective indicia of the framers' contrary intent and or purpose? Well, if the plain text should win, that means accepting the Constitution as is creates absurdities. If contrary intent and purpose are relevant, how do we divine that intent and purpose? All right, so that leads me to my third point. What if reasonable people disagree about what the text means and whether the text is static or dynamic? Examples, right? Congress's power to regulate commerce between the states. We may all agree about what commerce is. We may not agree about what it means to be between the states. At least one justice of the Supreme Court thinks that literally just means when stuff goes in trucks and ships and other transportation items over state lines. That's one vote. one and a half, right?
I don't get a vote.
We all get a vote. Isn't that the point? Second, equal protection of the laws. What the hell does that mean? Right? I dare anyone to come up with an originalist explanation for equal protection that has no debate over who's protected, what it means, and what the consequences are. Or my favorite, this is my favorite recent Supreme Court case, which bodies count as a state legislature? Under the Elections Clause, Article 1, Section 4, Clause 1, the Supreme Court just last year said with a straight face, an independent commission created by the people of Arizona is the Arizona legislature in a case brought by, wait for it, the Arizona legislature. Right? These are, terms that we might disagree about reasonably. And then the question is, how do we resolve the disagreement? So Justice Scalia once wrote that judges should, quote, look for meaning in the governing text, ascribe to that text the meaning that it has borne from its inception, and reject judicial speculation about both the drafter's extra-textually derived purposes and the desirability of the fair reading's anticipated consequences. But this assumes two conclusions that aren't at all self-evident. First, that we can read. No. First, it assumes that the drafters of the text themselves agreed on that meaning. Right? If you've read McCulloch versus Maryland, did James Madison and Alexander Hamilton agree on whether you could have a national bank? No. Are they two of the people who you might have asked? Yes. Right? So even Hamilton and Madison disagreed on so many issues as to make it hard to see there being a unitary, true, original meaning, however you're going to define that, whether it's public meaning, whether it's the meaning of the drafters, etc. To say nothing of the views of everyone who participated in the drafting and ratification of the provision at issue. Second, it assumes that even if Hamilton and Madison agreed, they never did, right? Well, except in the Compromise of 1790, per the song in the musical, but whatever. even if they agreed, it assumes that the text has had the same unquestionable meaning ever since its inception. And as one of many examples to the contrary, let me respectfully submit to you the 11th Amendment. The text of which is, to me, rather clear in what it's doing, that has been read to mean almost exactly the opposite. Now, perhaps a true dyed-in-the-wool originalist would simply say that the Supreme Court's 11th Amendment jurisprudence has been wrong since 1890, except that some of the most well-known originalists were in the middle of the majorities in those very cases. Right? So either originalism doesn't work, or Scalia and Thomas don't actually believe in it vis-a-vis the 11th Amendment. We'll see. All right. Steve's about to tell me why I'm totally wrong on that. This leads to my last point. In most cases, right, originalism, like most modes of constitutional interpretation, will be subjective, right? It'll be informed as much by the individual jurist's conception of which sources matter, which purposes are appropriate to consider, and which external considerations should come into play, as by the idea that there is a single objectively discernible original meaning to the text. All right, so concluding that originalism is subjective, it doesn't doom it as an enterprise, but it does suggest that it's not materially better or worse than other methods of interpreting the Constitution. It's just one of them, right? And we should start with it. So for me, right, originalism is not irrelevant, but in most cases it also ought not to be dispositive. Not because we don't or shouldn't care how the text was understood at the time it was adopted, but because that understanding is often going to raise as many questions as it answers, and only require the deployment of additional interpretive tools to resolve how much of that text should be understood today. So Steve defines living constitutionalism as legal changes that weren't legal when they happened, right? My response is, weren't legal according to whom? Right? If the text allows for evolving understandings of what a word means, why is it illegal, or at least not legal, for subsequent jurists to say, well, in this context, I understand this text to mean something different. Right? That, to me, is living constitutionalism, and not the notion that the president has to be at least 57.26 years old. So why don't I stop there and turn it back over to you.
Both of us should try to, you know, I'll certainly try to restrain myself in the amount of time we've been in part just because we want to get to your questions also, and so we definitely want this to be a back and forth with a lot of Q&A. I should say again, you know, I agree with virtually nothing of what was just said, but I think the important thing to distinguish is, there's a distinction between evolving understandings of what a rule requires as applied to different facts, and evolving understandings of what a word means. So an example of the latter would be something like the clause that says that the federal government will protect the states against domestic violence. I think everybody knows that that does not mean that the federal government will intervene when the states are not doing enough to prevent partner abuse, although that might be a good thing to be done anyway, and you might look for other powers under which the federal government might try that. But that's not what they were talking about. What they were talking about was rebellions and insurrections and things that they would have called domestic violence. The word just meant something different back then. And it would be as foolish to read it as meaning partner abuse today as it would be to pick up Chaucer and assume that sort of everything in it is written in 20th century English and should, you know, me and that, you know, Italians today are speaking very bad Latin or something like that. What we're dealing with here are not really evolving understandings of what the rule means. The question is, well, what the word means. The question is, what rule did those words express? What rule did they enact at the founding? And how does that rule apply in various times? As a second example, I think it's important to note that sometimes the law is really uncertain, and sometimes the law does unfortunately require us to look up really old stuff, and that can be unfortunate. I once saw a case where whether the old Dominion Boat Club in Alexandria, Virginia, that I live not far from, could block pedestrians from its waterfront depended on Maryland water law as of 1800, which was when a certain area was retroceded to the district, and then how it had been adapted since then. And so you had the DC Circuit trying to figure out what Maryland law had been in 1800 on boats and water and things like that. And that's, you know, that's a terrible use of federal judges' time in a certain sense, but the law, just the way it was written, required this patch of land, who owned it, depended on what the law was then. Likewise, I once saw a case involving a civil rights era murder. There was an ex post facto case. It was, what was the penalty for murder in this particular state in 1963 when the murder happened? The ex post facto clause requires us, as a matter of law, not to impose a worse punishment today than was on the books for murder at the time. And, you know, it's not fun to have to go back and look up the history and try and figure out what the rule was, but we just have something else in the law that requires us to do so.
Can I ask a question about the ex post facto clause?
Yeah.
Okay, so the ex post facto clause is a great example of where you and I might disagree, right? So we all agree that the ex post facto clause creates a general prohibition on imposing retroactive punishment. Can I say that?
Yes.
Okay. What does that mean?
It means, so I think that on certain things we know very well what it means, that the penalty for a crime can't be, you can't have crimes that weren't criminal when they occurred, you can't have penalties exceed.
What about different forms?
Different forms.
So
different.
Can I try a crime in a military commission, hypothetically, that has never been tried in a military commission before, but that's been a federal civilian criminal offense since 1871?
Yes, but we should talk about military commissions later, because that gets into other issues. And there are also questions. So, like, Justice Chase had a question back in the day about, does this apply to new kinds of evidence that would have been excluded? If we get rid of the marital privilege, and now people can testify to stuff that before people could have been secure, you know, they'll never know because I confess to my wife and she'll, you know, legally not be able to testify that in court. Is that an ex post facto violation? There can be in any legal rule core cases that we know are clear and peripheral cases that we're uncertain about. But I think that the problem is associating that with change over time, as opposed to saying that at any time throughout the spectrum, there are always going to be some cases of law that's clear and some cases of law that's unclear, and the sources for figuring out that unclarity depend on what the law was at any given time. Take another example from my experience as a CIVPRO teacher. 28 U.S.C. 1404, you can transfer cases in the interest of justice for the convenience of witnesses and parties, okay? People can disagree about which kinds of venue transfers serve the interest of justice and which are more convenient. That's obviously something that people can disagree about. But the reason why that disagreement is legally relevant is because there's a statute, 28 U.S.C. 1404, that says so. If the disagreements that people are having are the disagreements that the law requires, those are the right disagreements to have. And if the disagreements people are having are disagreements that the legal rule as adopted did not include and did not expect them to agree on, then that's a problem. If you look, for instance, at the question of, you know, $20, the question of excessive fines, it was whether something is excessive is a question that people can disagree on, and we are in some sense doomed by our adoption of the Eighth Amendment and our failure to repeal it since to have something we can disagree on in the Constitution. It's because it's there and was adopted in 1791, even if we would rather get rid of those hard questions, even if a judge would rather just say, anything more than $1 million is excessive and I'm never gonna answer another question about it. They can't do that because the Eighth Amendment doesn't say $1 million like the Seventh Amendment says 20, it says excessive. We are obliged under the legal system we have to respect the choices that were made in prior law and to have the questions that are uncertain be the questions that prior law left as uncertain. Now some things I think that there's more certainty than you find elsewhere. So for instance, I think that the reason why Professor Vladeck can say in the legislature case that it sounds a little funny what the Supreme Court did is because we understand that like maybe the Supreme Court kind of got it wrong there and maybe legislature had a more determinate meaning of its time. Now maybe not, maybe you think that it got the right answer, but if you did, then it shouldn't be all that, it shouldn't be a case where we find it funny. Like there's nothing amusing about the idea that the legislature might be a broader concept than the two houses that meet and pass bills, if that's what you think legislature really meant at the time, and what was the rule that ratifiers enacted back in 1788. I think part one other advantage of looking to things as a matter of original law rather than original meaning is that it helps answer questions like the 11th Amendment. So I'm going to agree with Professor Vladeck that the text of the 11th Amendment is only rebutting a certain inference that people made about Article 3 that was wrong. It was saying the decision that was made in Chisholm that individuals could sue states so long as they were from a different state, that was the wrong way to read Article 3. It was the wrong way to read Article 3 because there were pre-existing doctrines of who can sue a state that had nothing to do with the text of the Constitution that were being violated and that had not been repealed and that Congress had not even tried to abrogate, even assuming that it could. The decisions nowadays.
So you take the Iredell position.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, Iredell all the way. I think that.
That's a T-shirt, by the way. Iredell all the way.
Well, being from North Carolina.
I was going to say.
But decisions nowadays, like Alden v. Maine, and I think Seminole also says that what we're dealing with are rules that were not necessarily expressed in the Constitution, but that nonetheless remain law, just like all sorts of rules that are law that are outside the Constitution, and that haven't necessarily been abrogated by someone with power to abrogate them. So there are questions that can come up that are not necessarily confined to the text. Well, what we're really looking to is, what's the legal warrant for any particular rule? How did it become law? And this, I think, takes me back to the very first thing that Professor Vladeck said, the idea that we're in different republics. I think that that's wrong, and I think that that's wrong as a sort of dissettled matter of legal self-understanding. It's one thing to say that the Eighth Amendment asks whether a punishment is cruel, and different people at different times will disagree about cruelty. It's another thing to say that the Eighth Amendment no longer contains the same rule it did in 1791 because we had a big event since then that sort of threw out the old republic and established a new one. I certainly think that the 14th Amendment enacted in 1868 changed, in a political science sense, the nature of the government in the United States. But what's important is that they thought it very important to adhere to the forms of enactment of an Article 5 Amendment.
The second time.
or I mean, even the first time around. You know, you can argue about whether the slave states should have been excluded from Congress. But, you know,
I'm talking about 1787. There's at least two reforms.
Oh, yes. Oh, well, right. No, but I think that's why what's important to note is the change that was made in 1868 was a change within an existing system. We have the Constitution. We are not throwing it out. We are amending it. We're adding something through the mechanism of Article 5. The change in 1788 was not like that. The Articles of Confederation were broken when we adopted the Constitution. And you know what? Legally, that doesn't matter. The Articles of Confederation themselves and the Revolution was a violation of British law. I hate to break it to you guys. The people shooting at British soldiers were not obeying British law when they did so. But you know what? Legally, we don't care because we live in a society where we said our law goes back to the founding. It doesn't matter what shenanigans happened in the ratification of the Constitution. It was ratified. It's our law today. We celebrate Constitution Day. We don't celebrate Articles of Confederation Day. And we don't celebrate, you know, the Queen's birthday, or you know, the Stuarts. We always look back only so far and no farther. And I think that's a fundamentally important fact about our legal system. The reason why originalism is our law today is because we treat the Constitution in 1788 as having established law, and not any events further since then as having thrown it over.
So I have very little to say in response to that, because I'm not sure you actually disagree with me that much. Right? I mean, if the answer to some of our big interpretive problems, that there are just some questions that are not confined to the text, then that seems to me that originalism is only valuable if we accept that there are atextual objective answers to be defined from 1787-era practice. Right? And on sovereign immunity, it's probably the best example. There are rather powerful camps on both sides who read the same history differently. Right? Why is one of them right? Because they have 5 votes, right? Not because it's clear as a matter of objective historical fact that the Scalia, Rehnquist, Kennedy interpretation of that period is better than the Souter, Breyer, Ginsburg interpretation of that period. You know, that may just be a very legal realist answer, and that's fine, right? But insofar as it proves or somehow cements the value of originalism, I say no, it just proves that this is all sort of parts of the larger puzzle. The last thing I want to say, and then we should probably just throw open the questions. I think the Arizona case is actually a great example of the fight. So Steve says, we chuckle because it just seems silly that the legislature could actually be this totally bizarre group of people, you know, 9 guys named Joe sitting in a bar. To which I say, well, it depends on how you interpret that text, right? So maybe we could go back to the founding era and see that the drafters of the Elections Clause, when they said legislature, they meant, right, the houses of government elected in the state. Or maybe they meant something functional. That is to say, whoever that state's laws provide is in charge of determining state policy on this question. Those are 2 perfectly viable ways of interpreting the same text. I have my own view of which one is better. Steve may have his. Right? My point is that originalism can't solve it. Right? We can't say, oh, well, let's just get in our time, set the clock in the DeLorean, right, for September 1787, and we'll answer everything. We won't. And the thing is, I think the founders understood that. So, you know, in the grand fight between originalism and constitutionalism, I say they both lose, right? Because neither is or should ever be dispositive, right? Interpretation is an inherently evolving, subjective, man-made human discipline. And we can't just have a computer program do it. Despite the best efforts of your former boss, Chief Justice Roberts, who thinks that we should just have umpires, right? Call balls and strikes. How many of you guys are baseball fans? Why don't we have robots? I'm dead serious, right? If the only job of an umpire is to call balls and strikes, why don't we just have robots? Right?
Replay.
Right? And do robots run the replay?
Well, someday.
Yes, it's called Judgment Day, and the machines will take over, and this whole debate will become moot. So on that note, why don't we throw open the questions?
Question for Professor Sachs.
Sure.
Just aimed at helping us understand your views a little bit better. Of Plessy versus Ferguson, the NAACP education cases culminating in the court, which of those were rightly decided, which of those were wrongly decided, and how should we go about answering that question in the right way?
So I think it's not hard to conclude pretty quickly that Plessy was wrongly reasoned, in the sense that the framing of Plessy is something like this. it's a violation of equal protection if what you're doing is
Can we remind the 1Ls what Plessy is?
Plessy is the case that held that it was legal for Louisiana to require segregation on its trains. And the rationale was, oh, this is not a violation of equal protection because there's no disparagement or inequality here. No one's getting sort of objectively worse treatment. Just one group uses one car and one group uses another worse car in the back, and that's not actually unequal in any real way. And I think that, you know, the response that Charles Black had is what he called the sovereign prerogative of philosophers, namely laughter. That doesn't pass the laugh test. The reason why they thought that it did, you know, you can go into, and historically there were excellent, you know, sort of, let's put it this way, it was very widespread, but I don't think that anyone today, and lots of people even back then, would say that that passes the laugh test as a claim that no one should feel disparaged here. I think it was quite clear that the very purpose was to disparage and to say that one group ranks lower in the hierarchy. Now, I think, you know, in that sense, sort of Plessy is a very, very, is sort of a poor candidate because it has its own flaws. I think that, you know, if you look at the original history of the 14th Amendment, which is one of the areas that most of the fights are over, the reason why most of the fights are over is in part because there was a very concerted effort by people who didn't like the 14th Amendment, for who saw the 14th Amendment correctly as a radical amendment, to muddy the historical record immediately upon its enactment. You had Slaughterhouse, you had Cruikshank, you had cases where a lot of the people involved in passing the amendment looked at what the Supreme Court were doing and said, what is this? What are you, you know, you I think it was Justice Miller said, you've taken what was meant for bread and made it a stone. And you have immediately subverted the rules that we put in. A good example of this would be the rules on interracial marriage. A great study by Professor Upham in Dallas showed that every Republican judge shortly after the enactment of the 14th Amendment ruled that state laws against interracial marriage were unconstitutional because it was a privilege and immunity of citizens to be able to marry other citizens. It had been a disability of aliens, people who were strangers in this land, to not necessarily be able to marry citizens without special legal permission. And so by extending citizenship to everyone, that extended the right to intermarry.
So Slaughterhouse screwed it up.
Yes.
Okay.
And
we did Slaughterhouse and Conley yesterday.
Now, if that interpretation is right, and I haven't gone through and done the history, but you know, I'm inclined to think that it is, then you know, the original 14th Amendment might have been a lot more focused on equality than the interpretation of that amendment from, you know, Slaughterhouse up through relatively close to the present day. Now, in some ways, you know, that may feel like a cop-out because, you know, what you're saying is we're lucky that the 14th Amendment, you know, respects current views. But I think that what's important is that, A, you know, not necessarily, there might be other questions that where we think the 14th Amendment, we wish the 14th Amendment ought to do something. And yet, you know, if you do the historical work, it might turn out not to. I think that what is important to recognize is that when we talk about all of the, you know, 14th Amendment decisions, whether it's the, you know, equal treatment based on gender, or sort of all the voting rights cases, you know, the rules about reapportioning the states under equal protection, all of those cases, the way that the courts and the legal system understands them is 14th Amendment cases. They're cases about what the 14th Amendment legally required. And if you, you know, proposed repealing the 14th Amendment, people would say, that's terrible because all these important things that we like would go away. I think that what that signals to us is that people don't think that sort of the Constitution just in general, or there's some sort of nebulous legal principle just floating out in space, that all of these rulings that we think are really important have to be right because they just are so important. I think it's more than no. The claims that are made on their behalf is that they have legal warrant, that they were adopted as a result of the 14th Amendment. That's in some sense a historical and empirical claim. It's a claim that people can disagree about, but that disagreement doesn't necessarily have any sort of livingness, any change over time. What a particular court will do with it depends in part on what its members think. But the correct answers are questions of, you know, historical and empirical debate. And even if people consistently get them wrong, as they did for, you know, 80 plus years from Slaughterhouse on, that doesn't mean that the answers themselves change.
All right, so wait, so you lost me at gender, right? So is it your argument that the Equal Protection Clause was always meant to apply to sex-based discrimination? or that the Supreme Court has been wrong since 1971 to apply the Equal Protection Clause to sex-based discrimination, or should I say heightened scrutiny under the Equal Protection Clause?
My only claim is that I haven't done the research and don't yet know.
Okay.
But the cases that are there have stare decisis effect, and so when you don't know, even under the founding doctrines of stare decisis,
it's not my fault. It's Justice Brennan's.
Well, I mean, that was the doctrine of stare decisis. Caleb Nelson has a great paper on demonstrably erroneous cases. If you don't know that the case is wrong, you shouldn't overturn it. But if you, all I would say is that the correct answer is one to be figured out. You know, did the 14th Amendment do this, or did Justice Brennan do this? Those are two different questions. They can get different answers, and it's important to try and figure out what the correct answer is.
Professor Sager.
So, Mr. Jackson, it seems to me all the work in your argument is being done by a term that you haven't given us the content of, which is a rule. You know, you won't talk about meaning, you won't talk about intent, it's what rule was put in place. And the Equal Protection Clause is a vivid problem area for you. So, what is the meaning of the Equal Protection Clause? Is it a very general notion of social equality or political equality? Is it racial equality alone? At what level of, and who gets to decide things like what racial justice requires? Suppose we say it's racial justice, and it turns out that most of the people who enacted it think that segregation was consistent with racial justice, but we think not. Now you duck the hard questions, it seems to me, such as gender, by saying, I haven't done the research. This is, I guess, what I'd like to know. To understand what the content of a rule is and how we determine it. We want to know whether equal protection applies to women at all. We want to know whether equal protection applies to same-sex marriage claimants at all. Tell me what research you would do, given time enough, your Hercules.
Right.
What research would you do?
And you have an army of UT students to your work.
What research would you do at the time of enactment to answer the questions of gender and gay rights?
Can we piggyback that with Professor Abrali's question?
I'd like to point out that this entire discussion about how to interpret the Constitution is very misleading to these poor students in that the Supreme Court does not decide constitutional cases by looking at the Constitution. You know, that should be very obvious. It doesn't take a lot of sophistication. The question is same-sex marriage required by the Constitution? Let's go to the Constitution and look about that. Let's look at the same-sex marriage clause. The Constitution has nothing to do with it. Four liberals say, let's enact same-sex marriage. And four conservatives say no. It's purely political. It's ideological. The great Judge Richard Posner, a recent article in the Harvard Law Review, forward. It's a political court making political decisions. Now, the beginning of sophistication is to understand that. The Constitution has nothing to do with it. Does the Constitution say that Congress cannot bar contributions, limit the contributions in politics as the court held? The Constitution, the First Amendment required that? Four conservatives said yes. Four conservatives said no. And what the Constitution requires today or means depends entirely on how Kennedy votes.
So on that uplifting note, do you want to respond?
Yes. Let me respond to the growing first, because I think that it's important to get the basics right, and then we can get to things that are still very basic. So I think it depends a lot on how you understand how law works. So it is a fact about our legal system that certain people reliably get the short end of the stick in legal decisions. Certain people get higher criminal sentences than others, are more likely to be arrested for various things, and so on and so forth. That is a fact about practice under our legal system. That is different from it being the law. It is not the law in the United States that ethnic minorities must get increased sentences by X%. That's a fact about the United States, but it's not a legal fact. It's not part of our legal system. If you were trying to explain how the United States legal system works to a visiting Martian anthropologist, you wouldn't include that fact as one of our legal rules, even if you might describe it as a feature of the system. And the way that the legal system works in the United States, its self-understanding, sort of, you know, what H.L.A. Hart called the internal perspective, does not have a rule that the Constitution is whatever Anthony Kennedy says it is. So, nonetheless, it's the fact.
Except according to Justice Kennedy.
I say the Constitution has nothing to do with constitutional law. What do you say to that?
I would say that
what does it have to do with it? Why do you have a right, for example, to own a gun? All conservatives said you have that right. All liberals say no. You know, isn't it funny how they read it differently, always in the same ideological way? How sophisticated do you have to be? Why do we have a right to open our private weapons? Because Kennedy voted with conservatives on that one. That's why. If he voted the other way, we wouldn't have that right, and the Second Amendment would be just as happy as it is now.
So in some ways, that's sort of like it's sort of like a claim that grammar is whatever your third grade English teacher said it was, because your third grade English teacher was going to mark your papers up and down, and maybe there were certain pet peeves that person had, certain rules that they would enforce or not. Now, nonetheless, it's still true that grammar is something that, you know, society has to decide on. In some sense, English is whatever all of us speak. In some sense. But that doesn't mean that the one person who in a particular situation is the person entrusted with authority to make a decision about something always gets it right, or that there's no grounds for criticism. Another article by Caleb Nelson at Virginia, Caleb Nelson, who in general is always right, is that you can understand any lawyer in the United States today understands the following sentence. The Constitution says X, the Supreme Court has interpreted it to say why, and the Supreme Court is not about to change that decision. Those three sentences jointly make sense to any competent lawyer in the United States. No one would say, I can't figure out what you're saying here, I have no idea what that means. They understand that what the Constitution might require and what any particular institution might say that it requires are two different things. And so it might well be that the Holmesian bad man, the person who's only interested in, will I get arrested for this conduct, only cares about only sees law as whatever the judges say it is. But that doesn't mean that that's true of the legal system from the perspective of the faithful internal participant. And if you mix the two, you're going to get very confused when you try and figure out how a legal system works as a normative system, as a system of rules.
Before we get to the question, do you mind turning to Larry's question for a second, and then we'll get to the question.
Oh, no, I was
actually just
going
to sort of ask the same question that Professor Sager had, which is, how do you define, you personally as an originalist,
right,
how do you define the content of the 14th Amendment?
And how do you find it?
Right.
Sorry?
How do you find
exactly
it?
Exactly. Yes. How do you go about defining that?
Right. So I would say that you know, when we're trying to figure out like what the rule is, I think that essentially the question that we're trying to ask is like the question that we ask all the time when we're trying to figure out, I also teach conflict of laws. We're trying to figure out what's the law of a foreign society. So a case comes up, we know that it's going to be governed by the law of Japan. How do we figure out what the law of Japan is on this particular question of Japanese contracts? And so we look at various sources that are taken as authoritative on the law of Japan. We try and ask experts that we think know something. We look at how cases are coming out. We look at what their reasoning is. We try and figure out, you know, through all of the different lawyers' toolbox, what's the law of Japan on this particular topic today. Now, when you look at it from an originalist perspective, often what we do in the law is try and figure out, well, what was the law as of a prior time? And in some sense, you're doing exactly the same activity, just with a set of sources that's restricted in time. So whether it's an ex post facto case, whether we're trying to figure out like what was the law of murder in Alabama in 1963, you know, that is a question where, you know, you just crack open whatever tools you would ordinarily use to figure out the law and say, well, we're only looking at things that speak to the laws that stood in 1963.
So it's a very specific question. So to answer whether the Equal Protection Clause applies to sex-based classification.
Yes.
You would look to...
Give me just three sources you'd look to see if...
So you'd look to a lot of the debates in Congress over what sort of rule they thought they were adopting in the Equal Protection Clause. You'd look at uses of the phrase protection of the laws, and especially equal protection of laws prior to and shortly thereafter, to the extent that you think contra slaughterhouse, that the people using it thereafter are not trying to muddy the historical record. You would look to any subsequent cases interpreting it that, again, you have reason to believe are not trying to cut the rug out from under the standard.
And if those sources are ambiguous?
If those sources are ambiguous, then it's just like saying, my gosh, Japanese law is ambiguous, my gosh, 20 U.S.C. 1404 is ambiguous. And the legal system does have lots of other rules for helping us solve sometimes ambiguous questions. It has rules like stare decisis. It has rules like five votes before. But that doesn't mean that the ultimate content of the rule is whatever five votes say. The question is, you try and figure out what was the law that this particular provision enacted. Now, a lot of people argue, I should note, the problem in some sense is worse than you described. Because you're naming different, you know, was the 14th Amendment Equal Protection Clause merely directed at, you know, racial equality or gender equality? Whereas it's not entirely clear what it was equality of. So, for instance, Christopher Green has an excellent article arguing that, and I think John Harrison's taking this view also, that protection of the laws was a recognized category that meant essentially the idea that the executive was going to watch out for you, that you were within the protection of laws, you were not alien enemy against whom people could do bad things and the police wouldn't prosecute, you know, wouldn't go after it. And the promise of equal protection was the promise to all these people who had just been made citizens by the first sentence of Article 4, the 14th Amendment, Section 1, that you are entitled to equal protection from the government of your legal rights, whatever they are. And the definition of the legal rights is actually supplied by the Privileges and Immunities Clause, which has its own interpretive problem.
So it's all Slaughterhouse's fault.
Yes.
Okay.
But what I'm trying to say here is that these problems, I'm not trying to make light of these problems. I'm not trying to say originalism is the magic horse and unicorn that you ride in on, and, you know, it's like Rainbow Tail somehow solves all of the legal problems you might ever have. What I'm trying to say is that originalism is, in my view, the legally required approach that courts, lawyers, judges, anybody else would be trying to use to answer what the law has been and what it is today, and the things that are uncertain under that are the areas of law that are uncertain.
All right, I promise we will stick around for a couple minutes, but why don't we take one last question from the audience for now, and then if you have other questions, come ask us after.
Yes.
But, sir.
Yeah, hi. One question to Professor Sachs. To what degree is originalism adjustable? And I have a very simplified example. How would an originalist approach interpret the Seventh Amendment?
Yep.
Let's say if the dollar's value increases to the value where we get paid only $5 per month, does this mean we would have an issue worth it, let's say, 4 months? Is that correct? Because I'm a lawyer and that's math.
Right.
But
under the understanding that there would be no math.
That we have to have that kind of
yes.
case to have a trial by jury?
So
is this adjustable to?
This is a great example of the principle that the choice of rule is a choice about what kinds of changes make a difference. The idea of inflation, the idea that money might be worth more or less depending on events, was not absent from the founders. You guys might have heard the antique expression, not worth a continental. They knew that sometimes when you start, you know, printing currency or making the leaf legal tender, you're going to have inflation. Like, they knew that if you're just printing money all over the place, then the value of the dollar will change. They did not say in the Seventh Amendment, $20 measured in sheep or gold or whatever. You know, they could have done that. They could have said, you know, anything worth this amount in commodities. Instead, they said $20. One reason is because they probably didn't trust the Congress that they were not allowing to monkey around with jury trials, not to monkey around with inflation statistics. They just said, you know what? Better we just say $20, leave it at that, and that'll be our rule. That was a choice of a rule. It might have been a terrible choice of a rule. Maybe that was really dumb. Maybe they should have said $20 or 8 ounces of gold, whichever is more or whatever. But that's not the rule they chose. And so today, the rule that's still on the books, not having been altered, is $20. And it might well be that that rule makes less sense today than it did back then, in just the same way that maybe subsidies for tobacco production make less sense today than they did when the Congress first enacted them. And that's an argument for amendment or repeal. But that's not an argument that the rule itself means anything different than it did.
All right, so yes, no question.
Yes.
Does the Vice President preside over his own impeachment?
Probably.
All right, no, that's it. I think that's the last.